الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى المجتبى. My brothers and my sisters, today I would like to discuss inshallah ta'ala something that is relevant for anybody who is trying to taste the sweetness of ilm. Or shall I say, he's trying to taste the sweetness of the Quran. Because my brothers and my sisters, we may have tried and tried and tried, but it just doesn't seem to be happening. Because maybe, my brothers and my sisters, there is preventatives, something that is stopping us from being able to attain that nur, that light. And you have to understand, my brothers and my sisters, and this is what Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned in his Talbisu Iblis. He says, فَإِنَّ أَوَّلَ تَلْبِيسُ إِبْلِيسِ هُوَ صَدُّهُمْ عَنِ الْعِلْمِ. The first deception of Iblis was to block the people away from knowledge. لِأَنَّ الْعِلْمَ نُورٌ. Because this ilm is a light. فَإِذَا أَطْفَأَ مَصَابِيحَهُمْ خَبَّطَهُمْ فِي الظُّلَمِ كَيْفَ شَاءَ. If he manages to switch off that light, he will throw them into the darkness. So the Iblis, my brothers and my sisters, is always trying in different ways and forms in order to block an individual away from attaining the anur. My brothers and my sisters, in my years of seeking knowledge, when I was in Yemen and also while being in Medina, I always used to wonder why. Why is this brother struggling? He's not dumb. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him intelligence. He tries to open the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. After 2 minutes, he closes it. He opens it again. 2 minutes after that, he closes it. He goes and he comes back, tries to read it. Just doesn't seem to be happening. And like I said, my brothers and my sisters, it's not that he's dumb or he has learning difficulties. This ilm, my brothers and my sisters, is not like learning medicine or engineering and things like that. This ilm is different. There's a tariqah for it. And there's a number of things that stop and prevent an individual from being able to attain that ilm. And inshallah ta'ala, in this sitting, I would like to discuss some of these points. The first issue, my brothers and my sisters, is تطهير وعاء العلم أو تطهير وعاء العلم. It is to purify the vessel of knowledge, and that is the heart. One has to purify the heart. And as our Shaykh Saleh bin Abdullah bin Hamad al-Usaymi, he mentions in his kitab called Ta'zeem al-Ilm, the more pure your heart is, the more that ilm will enter inside of it. And I would like to mention, inshallah ta'ala, my brothers and my sisters, three types of diseases and illnesses of the heart. That you find that the talib ilm, the student who is trying to attain knowledge, or he's trying to attain the sweetness of the Quran, is being afflicted with a lot of the time. One is general and the other two are more specific. The first point, my brothers and my sisters, that comes under this is al-ma'asi in general. Sinning. One time, my brothers and my sisters, Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he sat down in front of Imam Malik. Two great scholars from the four great a'imma. We have Imam Ahmad, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he sits down in front of Imam Malik. Imam Malik sees how sharp and intelligent he is. You know what he says to him, my brothers and my sisters? Inni ara anna Allah qad alqa fi qalbika nuran fala tutfiha bi dhulmati al-ma'siyah. I can see that Allah Azza wa Jal has placed a nur in your heart, a light in your heart. Do not extinguish this light with the darkness of sinning. When Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala listed a whole load of effects of sins in his kitab al-da'u wa al-dawa, the first effect of sin that he mentioned was hirmanul ilm, to be deprived of knowledge. Your memorization begins to get affected. You want to taste the sweetness of the Quran. It's not happening. Why? Because you might be somebody who is involved in sin. And then he brought this example, this incident between Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala and also Imam Malik.
We know the famous lines of poetry, right? شَكَوْتُ إِلَىٰ وَكِيعٍ سُوَ حِفْظِي فَأَرْشَدَنِي إِلَىٰ تَرْكِ الْمَعَاصِي. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, I complained to Waqi', who was his teacher, my bad memory loss. فَأَرْشَدَنِي إِلَىٰ تَرْكِ الْمَعَاصِي. He told me to leave off sinning. فَأَخْبَرَنِي بِأَنَّ الْعِلْمَ نُورٌ وَنُورُ اللَّهِ لَا يُهْدَى لِعَاصِي. He told me that this ilm is a nur. And this light, this nur, is not given to somebody who is a sinner. You know, my brothers and my sisters, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, his hifd was so good. He had to cover one side of the book just so the other side can go in. Because if he doesn't cover it, it'll end up getting mixed up. That's how powerful his hifd was. Imam Waqi' ibn al-Jarrah, his teacher, could have easily said to him, don't worry, Ya Shafi'i, your glory days are behind you. You got nothing to worry about. You've memorized, you've studied, you've taught. You're at the end of your life, you're old now. He didn't say that to him. He said to him, leave off sinning. And you know, they also say, my brothers and my sisters, his memory became affected because of him seeing the ankles of a woman which had bangles on there. The ankles, he saw it and it affected his memory. Imagine in this day and age where the society that we're living in has been so sexualized. It's half naked. I think maybe saying half naked is an understatement of how women are walking outside today. Especially in the last few days, right? Thursday was the hottest day of the year in the UK. Looking at things like that, my brothers and my sisters, or watching things that one shouldn't be watching on the internet, on Instagram, especially Instagram, my brothers and my sisters, especially Instagram. When some brothers, they gave me an account many years ago, they gave me a piece of advice. You know what they said? Don't click on the search button. Because of the filth and the evil that comes up from there. Ala kulli hal, my brothers and my sisters, I always wondered why Imam Shafi'i went to Waqi', even though he had many teachers. Why did he specifically go to him? Then I found something in Sir Alam al-Nubala, Lidhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala, that Ali ibn Khashram, he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ بِيَدِ وَكِيعٍ كِتَابًا قَطْ. I never ever saw Waqi' ever carrying a book. The man who advised Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. إِنَّمَا هُوَ الْحِفْظ. Everything that he ever mentioned was from the top of his head. Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? So he asked him, مَا دَوَاءُ النِّسْيَانِ. What is the cure for forgetting and memory loss? He said to him, if I was to tell you, are you going to act upon it? He said, إِيَ وَاللَّهِ, I will. He said to him, تَرْكُ الْمَعَاصِي مَا جَرَّبْتُ مِثْلَهُ قَطْ. Leave off sinning, I haven't tried anything like it. That's what Waqi' ibn al-Jarrah rahimahullah ta'ala was known for. You know, my brothers and my sisters, my parents from a very young age, they used to say to me, especially my mother, she used to say, Muhammad, if you want to memorize the Quran, you won't be able to do so if you're listening to music as well. These are two things that don't come together. And I used to look at her, what on earth is she talking about? How is that even possible? What do you mean? Why can you not do both at the same time? But you know, when we're young, we always think that our parents are backwards, right? They don't have a clue what they're talking about. Later on, my brothers and my sisters, I came across a line of poetry by Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala in his Nuniyah. He says, حُبُّ الْكِتَابِ وَحُبُّ أَلْحَانِ الْغِنَى فِي قَلْبِ عَبْدٍ لَيْسَ يَجْتَمِعَانِ. The love of music and the love of the Qur'an are two things that cannot come together in the same heart. It's impossible. And wallahi, it's very, very true. You will keep being held back. My brothers and my sisters, there was a brother who was in the same class as me. He was from the West. He did not have learning difficulties. Our week in Saudi Arabia when we're studying in Medina, it starts on a Sunday. Over here in the UK, it's Monday. Every time he walked in on Sunday, I could see there was something wrong. His face looked different. And this is from the effects of sinning, my brothers and my sisters. That when one sins, it starts appearing on his face. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he said this. He said, إِنَّ لِلْحَسَنَةِ ضِيَاءً لِلْوَجْهِ وَإِنَّ لِلْسَيَّةِ ظُلْمَةً لِلْوَجْهِ. The good deed that one does, it puts a glow on his face. And the bad deed that he does, it starts making his face dark. He was struggling in his exams, in his studies, he was falling behind. Wallahi, I saw this brother, it's as if he had invisible chains. Invisible chains in the jami'ah. One time he was walking home and I advised him. The moment I started speaking to him about sins, and credit to him, he was very, very attentive. He was like, say that again, what did you say? He took it straight on board. You know, later on, my brothers and my sisters, huh? He called me on the phone, just as we are about to break up for the summer holidays. He kept on calling me, kept on messaging me. I'm like, what's wrong with his brother? He knows that everyone's getting ready to go back. So I went to meet him and we sat down in the masjid. You know, my brothers and my sisters, the first thing that he said to me, brother, I want to kill my girlfriend. Wallahi al-azim, and I'm sitting in the masjid with him. Like, where do I even start in advising this individual? Normally you wouldn't think that somebody who has left his home, he lives in Europe, he came here all the way here to be involved in such a thing. But not everybody, my brothers and my sisters, that goes to the university, who is studying abroad, is always as righteous as we may think. Some people get accepted, but they still have a lot of baggage with them, which continues on with them when they get there. Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? And I said to him, do you remember when I advised you? He said, yes, that's why I called you. And you wonder why, my brothers and my sisters, why he was struggling. One time he said to me, brother, I want to get a bit more serious. I said to him, come to the haram. The brother can't sit in the haram. He's agitating to leave. He has invisible chains on his hands and likewise his feet that is stopping him. I've had other brothers, wallahi al-azim, my brothers and my sisters, who was addicted to watching pornography. He's crying his eyes out, breaking down in front of me. And we're sitting in the haram. He's addicted. He's trying to study, he's trying to memorize. It is not happening. This is a big effect of sin. So that leads me to another point, my brothers and my sisters. Something that Raghib al-Asfahani, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned. And this is something that is relevant in this day and age. He mentioned this hundreds of years ago. But recently, when I was pondering upon this statement, I said, subhanAllah, out of amazement. You know what he said, guys? لَيْسَ إِعْدَاءُ الْجَلِيسِ لِجَلِيسِهِ بِمَقَالَةٍ أَوْ بِفَعَالَةٍ فَقَطْ. You know how we are always told, right? And it's right. لا شك ولا ريب, no doubt about it. That the people we hang around with will affect the way we become, right? The bad friend is going to affect our attitude and our behavior. Our parents tell us this all the time. He says, it is not only what we hear and what the people do around us that affects us. It's not only that. He says, بَلْ بِالنَّظَرِ أَيْضًا. It is also by looking at things that affect an individual. And wallahi al-azim, my brothers and my sisters, this social media, the filth and the evil that is on there, is one of the biggest destroyers of your pursuit of knowledge and you trying to have a relationship with the Quran. Like I said to you guys earlier, right? The brothers, they gave me an account on Instagram, even though I didn't want it. But they told me all the kids are on there. But they said to me, don't press on the search button. The filth and the evil. And you wonder why. I remember when I was in Yemen, one of the mashayikh, he called it Fitnagram. And he called Facebook Fiskbook. The book of transgression. And wallahi, it's very, very right and correct why they would say that. Just about everything you click on, there is the opposite agenda. And every time you look at something you shouldn't be looking at, take it this way, that you're gonna forget something that you memorized. And an extra dot is placed on your heart, which is what? Going to seal it. Another thing that I want to mention, my brothers and my sisters, is what Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani was the one who explained the most authentic book after the book of Allah, which is Al-Bukhari. Sah. He was speaking about an individual called Al-Hafid ibn Sind. My brothers and my sisters, you cannot receive this title of being called a Hafid until you've memorized 100,000 hadith. That's when you get this title of Hafid. You know what he said about Hafid ibn Sind? When he was speaking about his life? فَنَثِيَ غَالِبَ مَحْفُوظَاتِهِ حَتَّى الْقُرْآنَ. He forgot the majority of what he memorized. He also forgot the Quran. You know why, guys? وَقِيل إِنَّ ذَلِكَ كَانَ بِسَبَبِ وَقِيعَتِهِ فِي النَّاسِ. It was because he was known to constantly rip into the honors of others. Jazakallah khair. He always used to speak about others. And this is something that I've seen over the years as well, my brothers and my sisters, individuals who have been trialed with al-jarh wa tajrih, sitting around, ripping into the flesh of other scholars and also other students of knowledge over issues that wallahi has no basis whatsoever. There's a difference between when you say so-and-so, he's got something wrong, and we need to stay away from that mistake that he fell into. But sitting around joking about people's honors, calling other people innovators and kuffar, even though calling other people kuffar and innovators is part of our religion, but these brothers, they weren't doing it properly. Aslan is not even their place to do it. These are big, huge issues of our religion. A lot of the time, my brothers and my sisters, I seen them, they left Yemen. And even today in the university, I see them dropping out one by one. And I know exactly who they are. Their hearts have become so hard. Khalas. The desire to carry on seeking knowledge is no longer there, because his heart has been sealed. There is something preventing him. Just because you may have been saved from looking at things you shouldn't be looking at, the shaitan comes from another door. This other door is what? You need to give victory to the religion. How? By speaking about so-and-so to protect so-and-so. كُلُّ هَذَا كَلَامْ فَارِقْ. Is all empty speech. So generally speaking, my brothers and my sisters, sins is going to stop you from memorizing. Maybe your parents are trying to take you to duksi. You're trying to memorize. Then you go home, you've already forgot, and then you forgot. You have to understand what is wrong. Why you are finding difficulty. The second point, my brothers and my sisters, and Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions this in Mukhtasar min Hajj al-Qasidin. He says, من موانع فهم القرآن والتلذذ به, he mentioned three things. That which prevents a person from gaining an understanding of the Qur'an and also tasting the sweetness of it. He mentions three things. The first one was, أن يكون مصرًا على ذنب. He is somebody, he's continuously sinning, and we've already discussed it. The second thing, my brothers and my sisters, he says, أن يكون متصفًا بالكبر. He is somebody who is arrogant. He has that fault of being arrogant. And la shakka wa la raib, my brothers and my sisters, this is one of the greatest awa'iq. From the biggest obstacles that a student faces and preventative that prevents the ilm from entering into his heart. He has to remove that kibr, that arrogance from his heart. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was asked, what is al-kibr? He said, bataru al-haqqi wa ghamtu al-nas. To belittle others and to also reject the truth. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, and you can find this in Majmu' al-Fatawa, وَكَثِيرٌ مِنَ الْمُنْتَسِبِينَ إِلَى الْعِلْمِ يُبْتَلَى بِالْكِبْرِ كَمَا يُبْتَلَى أَهْلُ الْعِبَادَةِ بِالشِّرْكِ. Many people who ascribe themselves back to knowledge, they are trialed with what? They are trialed with arrogance. The same way the people of ibadah are trialed with what? With shirk. Then he goes on to say, وَيُحْرَمُونَ حَقِيقَةُ الْعِلْمِ. They are then deprived of the reality of knowledge. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala has some nice speech with regards to mansha al-kibr, how the arrogance comes about. He says, al-kibru atharun min athar al-ujbi. Arrogance, my brothers and my sisters, is a consequence of being self-amazed with oneself. والبغي من قلب قد امتلأ بالجهل والظلم وترحلت منه العبودية. He became self-amazed with himself. He's proud of himself. And when Abdullah ibn Mubarak, my brothers and my sisters, was asked about al-kibr, he said, and تزدري الناس, to belittle others. Then he was asked about al-ujb. He responded back and he said, أن يرى أن لأن عنده شيئا ليس عند غيره. He sees himself to have something that other people don't. He's walking on the face of this earth thinking that he's better than others. And then that causes him what? Later on to always think that he's right and everyone else is wrong. And because of that, he belittles others and he also what? Rejects the truth when it's brought to him. I know something really, really powerful that touched my heart when I read Fudayl ibn Iyad, the great tabi'i, when he was asked about tawadu'. We all want tawadu', my brothers and my sisters, alayhi kadhalik. This sifa, this characteristic, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَا تَوَاضَ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا إِلَّا رَفَعَهُ. Never does a person humble himself except that Allah raises him, right? And we all want to be raised in this dunya and likewise the akhirah. He said, أن تخضع للحق وتنقاد له. To submit to the truth and to lower yourself for it. Then you know what he said, guys? And here comes the catch. وَلَوْ سَمِعْتَهُ مِنْ أَجْهَلِ النَّاسِ قَبِلْتَهُ مِنْ. Even if you was to hear it from the most ignorant of people, you accept it. وَلَوْ سَمِعْتَهُ مِنْ صَبِيٍّ قَبِلْتَهُ مِنْ. Even if you was to hear it from a little kid, he comes and he corrects you, you accept it. Sometimes you're the imam, or sometimes you're someone who is in a very high position. A little 14-year-old or 11-year-old comes up to you and says, you made a mistake. Are you going to turn around and say, I memorized the Quran 20 years ago, who are you to come tell me? Hada kibr. You want to tell me, and I'm older than you, hada kibr. Wallahi, I heard with these very two ears, a man saying, I've been in the da'wah before you knew what a sandwich was. I've been in the da'wah before you even knew what a sandwich was. He knew the way of the salaf before others knew what a sandwich was. Who are you to come tell me what's right and what's wrong? Hada kibr. A little kid, my brothers and my sisters, I heard some elder say, huh? I used to wash your urine. Now you want to tell me what's right and what's wrong? سَمِعْتُ ذَلِكِ بِأُذْنَيَّ. This sifa, my brothers and my sisters, sifatun iblisiyya, shaytaniyya, fir'auniyya. Isn't this what kicked Iblis out of the Jannah that he was in? Sawa ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, usulul khataya kulluha thalath. Where the sins stem off from, the foundation of where the sins stem off from are all three. The first thing that he mentions is what? Al-kibr, arrogance. وهو الذي أصار إبليس إلى ما أصاره. This is what caused Iblis to become whatever he became. أَأَسْجُدُ لِمَنْ خَلَقْتَ طِينَ. You want me, huh? To prostrate to someone you created from clay? أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ. It was always أَنَا. I am better than him. خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. You created me from what? Fire. And you created him from clay. And you want me to prostrate to him? When Allah Azza wa Jal told him to come with that which he told him to come with. And that is the truth. But he refused. Then Ibn al-Qayyim, he says, Al-kufru min al-kibri. The kufr that a person falls into, the disbelief, it comes and stems off from what? Originates from the arrogance that one comes with. Also, my brothers and my sisters, wasn't this what Fir'aun came with? Musa alayhi salatu wasalam comes to him and he tells him the truth. قالوا ألم نربك فينا وليدا ولبثت فينا من عمرك سنين. Didn't we nurture you as a young child? He told Musa that. And you spent a part of your life with us. Now you want to come tell me what's right and what's wrong? Get the hell out of here. That's what he told him. هذا كبر. And you know what's even more difficult than that, my brothers and my sisters? Is to accept the truth sometimes from people that we hate. And this is what Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala mentions, that sometimes our ego gets in the way. And it's really difficult. I'm not going to sit here, talk like it's something that is easy. Wallahi, it's not. This is why Ibn al-Qayyim said, لا تصلح لك درجة التواضع حتى تقبل الحق ممن تحب وممن تبغض. You will not be able to reach the level of being humble until you accept the truth from the people that you love and the people that you hate. That is a tawadu. So that brings me, my brothers and my sisters, how this is relevant to the student of knowledge. Some things that I've witnessed. Two brothers, they start the university at the same time. One of them started seeking knowledge, one of them started practicing before the other. Both of them need that lesson that's being opened up. But the one who started practicing before the other, he doesn't want to attend. لماذا? He doesn't want the other guy to see that he's needy or he doesn't know. هذا كبر. هذا كبر. Mujahid, a student Ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنه, was asked. He said, لا يتعلم العلم مستحن ولا مستكبر. Two people don't learn. The one who's arrogant and the one who's shy. The one who's arrogant thinks he knows it all. This is very, very prevalent, guys. Wallahi, I met some scholars. I'll give you guys an example of one sheikh who is a teacher in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's masjid. That's the highest level that you could come or reach. To be able to teach in front of the grave. Wallahi, ya ikhwa. When another sheikh comes from Riyadh to teach fiqh, this other teacher goes and sits down. This name is what? His name is Sheikh Amir Bahjat. Sheikh Abdul Salam al-Shuwayr comes, he goes and sits down right in the front, not like in the back. He acts like he doesn't need it, where in fact he's trying to listen. He needs the ilm. He goes, sits right in the front, pen and paper. And still, when you look at that Sheikh who sits right in the front and is taking down notes, wallah, he's very young in age. And I used to wonder, how did he get a chair so young in age? And it made sense to me later on because he was mutawadha. He was somebody who was so humble. When you talk to him, he doesn't talk to you like he is more higher than you. Or he's got more knowledge than you. Not at all. That brings me to a point, my brothers and my sisters. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was a wonderful example when it comes to being mutawadha. If you want this knowledge, my brothers and my sisters, you have to be the type of individual who is ready to wipe his forehead on the floor out of humility. Walking around with a pen and paper, what was that fa'idah you said again? And he takes it down. Sometimes you mention a fa'idah to somebody, he acts like he knows, but he doesn't. He just doesn't want to show it because he believes this is a weakness. Or people are going to think that he doesn't know. But the person who's mutawadhi, when he hears something, he doesn't shy away from saying, oh brother, send that fa'idah to me. Oh, let me hear that again. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, my brothers and my sisters, he was very young when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, right? They say he was around maybe 7 or 8. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him, right? اللهم علمه التأويل اللهم فقهه في الدين اللهم علمه القرآن. Oh Allah, teach him the Quran. Oh Allah, teach him the interpretation of the Quran. Oh Allah, give him an understanding of the religion. Different riwayat, different narrations. He could have easily said, the Messenger made dua for me sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I don't need to go and seek knowledge. I don't need to go sit in the circles where the poor are sitting. I'm the cousin of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm from Ahlul Bayt. I am from the family of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My lineage is honorable. And still the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for me. He did not say that. You know when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away? He said to an Ansari, halumma bina ila ashabi rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fa innahum al-yawma kathir. Let us all go to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam's companions. For indeed there's many of them today. There's many of them today. Let's go. He's telling the Ansari. You know what the Ansari said to him? أَتَرَ النَّاسَ يَفْتَخِرُونَ إِلَى مَا عِنْدَكَ. Do you really, really think, Ibn Abbas, people are going to need what you have when there's so many of the companions? Ibn Abbas said, فَأَعْرَضْتُ عَنْهُ. I turned away from him. Ibn Abbas, my brothers and my sisters, was a type of individual who would take his scarf. Huh? How do you guys feel about Thursday, my brothers and my sisters? How hot it was. Huh? We was burning, huh? خُلْنَارُ جَهَنَّمَا شَدُّ حَرًّا لَوْ كَانُ يَفْخَهُونَ. It was really, really hot. Really, really hot. The type of heat they have in the Arabian Peninsula is very different, my brothers and my sisters, from the wonderful British weather. After Dhuhr, he would go to the house of Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He would put his scarf on like that. Because it was dusty as well. It was hot. Then he would go sit on his doorstep, waiting for his teachers to come out. When Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala comes out, he says to him, Ibn Abbas, O cousin of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if you told me, I would have come to you. He said, La. Al-ilmu yu'ta wa la ya'ti. Ilm is traveled to, not the other way around. This Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala, he would sit there at the doorstep in humility, waiting for that ilm so he can attain it. Also, my brothers and I say, sometimes Zayd ibn Thabit would be on top of his riding animal. Ibn Abbas is a student, right? He would take the riding animal by the reins. He would be the one that is taking it. Zayd ibn Thabit would feel bad. Ibn Abbas, why are you doing this? You shouldn't be doing this. He goes, La, hakada umirna an nasna' bi ulama'ina. This is what we were commanded with to do with our scholars. Humbleness, humility. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala in Majmu' al-Fatawa, you find, he says, أَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ بِالتَّفْسِيرِ أَهْلُ مَكَّةِ. The most knowledgeable when it comes to the tafsir are the people of Mecca. Why? لِأَنَّهُمْ أَصْحَابُ ibn Abbas. Because they were the companions and the students of Ibn Abbas. رضي الله تعالى عنه. Humility, my brothers and my sisters, is something that we all need. Not only is it going to raise us in this dunya and likewise the akhirah, but you find this is what's going to get you somewhere. As for speaking from your nose, thinking you're better than others, not attending classes because some of the people that you taught are there, or people that were back home, maybe you were more knowledgeable than them at a time, and you don't want other people to see that you don't have something or you don't know, or that you're actually writing something that you didn't know. كل هذا من الكبر. This is all from arrogance. As our Sheikh Abdul Salam al-Shu'ayr mentioned. Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? Also what our Sheikh Abdul Salam al-Shu'ayr, he mentions, what some people say, كيف يجلس من هو فوق الأربعين مع من دون عشرين. How can somebody who is 40 years old sit with the one who is 20? He says, هذا كبر. هذا كبر. Just the other day I was telling one of the brothers that I was teaching in East London, who was saying he wants to memorize the Quran, but he doesn't have a teacher except for 2 days a week. You know, I said to him, my brothers and my sister, and this brother is 18 years old. If the only access you have to study in the Quran full time, just to sit in front of kids that are much, much younger than you and you don't have any alternatives, from tawadu is that you go there. From tawadu is that you go there. You will feel humiliated. Your teacher might speak to you like an 11-year-old, the same way he's speaking to the rest. But you accept it because you need something that he has. And in ilm, my brothers and my, sometimes you're humiliated by your teacher. This is one of the lessons that we take from the story of Musa and Khadr. What did he say to him? فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي عَنْ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى أُحْدِثَ لَكَ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا. Don't ask me anything again. He basically told him to shut up. Because he was told to go to him, right? He was sent to Khadir alayhi salatu wasalam. And when he kept on asking too many questions, he told him, فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي عَنْ شَيْءٍ. Don't ask me anything. And he went quiet. You will get humiliated sometimes. You will be embarrassed. That is exactly what's going to happen. So the poet, he says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَصْبِرْ عَلَى ذُلِّ التَّعَلُّمِ سَاعَةً تَجَرَّعَ كَأْسَ الْجَهْلِ طُولَ حَيَاتِهِ. Whoever is not patient for an hour being humiliated, he will carry on drinking ignorance for the rest of his life. Just have to take it. This is why our Sheikh Rushaydan, who has the deadliest halaqa in the haram, they make you read the hadith backwards. They make you read the hadith backwards. Imagine 40 an-Nawi, hadith number 42. It tells you go backwards. 41, 40, 39, 38. And it tells you jump 10 and come back 5. And when you're memorizing gabay, you know, poetry, you have to go up. Keep going down and up, down and up. And until he makes you humble and he humiliates the life out of you, he won't allow you in the halqa. He will make you cry. Wallahi, brother said to me, when he humiliated me, forget him, man. Westerners and also Arabs. The halaqat are many. Go somewhere else. Why are you sitting in front of him for? He doesn't memorize like that. Why is he making the students memorize like that? It was painful. Wallahi, it was painful. But I knew he has something that others don't have. A lot of people went to him, but they ended up leaving. I ain't gonna be treated like this. But wallahi, those in the halqa, their hifd is like water. The way we read Fatiha, right? That's how they memorize in Bulugh al-Maram. Umdat al-Ahkam, Bayquniya, and the rest of the Mandumat. You'll be humiliated and embarrassed, but it's only for a moment when you think about it. And later on you will realize. Another sickness, my brothers and my sisters, is al-hasad. Having envy, jealousy for others. And Imam Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that the hasad among students of knowledge, the envy among students of knowledge is more severe than the ones between the people of dunya. One time Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said to his students, اعلموا رحمكم الله. He told them, no, may Allah have mercy upon you. أن الرجل من أهل العلم, that a man from the people of knowledge, إذا منحه الله شيئا من العلم وحرمه قرناءه وأشكاله, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives knowledge to someone, but other people like his classmates are not given the same knowledge, they are prevented, حسدوه, they begin to have hasad for him. فَرَمَوْهُ بِمَا لَيْسَ فِيهِ, and they begin to accuse him with that which has no basis whatsoever. They begin to what? Accuse him of really bad things. وَبِئْسَتِ الْخَصْلَةُ فِي أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ. What a bad, evil characteristic in the people of knowledge. Imam Ahmad says this. It is really, really severe. Sometimes, my brothers and my sisters, when you are in that type of environment, it can be very hostile. This again is a sickness and the disease of the heart. Also, let's now look at what happened to Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. As-Subki, he says, وَلَا يَرْتَابُ الْمُنْصِفُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدْ ابْنِ يَحْيَى أَيَ الذُّهْلِ لَحِقَتْهُ آفَةُ الْحَسَدِ أَلَّتِي لَمْ يَسْلَمْ مِنْهَا إِلَّا أَهْلُ الْعِصْمَةِ. Because anyone who's fair and just will see that Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Dhuhli, we'll come to know in a moment who he is, was overwhelmed or was taken by envy. He was taken by envy. And this is something, my brothers and my sisters, that many people are not free from except the one Allah Azza wa Jalla has protected. So who was this individual, Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Dhuhli? Muhammad ibn Hamid al-Bazzar qala sami'tu al-Hasan ibn Muhammad ibn Jabir yaqul sami'tu Muhammad ibn Yahya. Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Dhuhli rahimahullah was heard saying lamma warada Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari Naysabur. When Imam al-Bukhari came to Naysabur, you know what he said, guys? اذهبوا إلى هذا الرجل. Go to this man. إلى هذا الرجل الصالح فاسمعوا منه. Take knowledge from him. Take the narrations, take the hadith from him. فذهب الناس إليه. So the students that he was teaching, they went to Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. وأقبلوا على السماع منه, and they started listening, taking a hadith from him. حتى ظهر الخلل في مجلس محمد بن يحيى. Until my brothers and my sisters, there started being gaps in the sittings of Muhammad ibn Yahya. Because people were leaving now. And Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari was more knowledgeable. And when he began to see some of his students leaving, حسده بعد ذلك فتكلم فيه. He started having envy and jealousy. And he started speaking ill about him. But you know, Imam al-Bukhari never took that personally. He did not take that personally. He still mentioned Muhammad ibn Yahya from his teachers in a Sahih Bukhari. You will find a chain of narration that counts him as one of his teachers. Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? And that's a wonderful characteristic. Even though he spoke about him, he distorted his reputation and so on and so forth. All of this goes back to, my brothers and my sisters, cleansing the vessel of knowledge, and that is what? The heart. We spend hours and hours in the gym, right? 120, 130 kilos, 140. 8 hours. Just to perfect the outer appearance. Sah. Put your hand up if you go to the gym. Nothing wrong with it. Just jayid, like you're actually looking after yourself. And then the sister, she spends hours in front of the mirror. Sah. Says she's gonna look great. All of this is to perfect the outer appearance. What if we just spend a fraction of that to perfect our hearts? Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَىٰ إِلَىٰ أَجْسَادِكُمْ. Allah does not look at how you, or how your outer appearance is. How big, how small, how thin, how fat you are. How yellow, how black, how white, how red. Allah doesn't look at that. But he looks at two things. وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَلَىٰ إِلَىٰ أَجْسَادِكُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jal, he looks at your hearts and also at your actions. I'm going to be very, very quickly, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to mention two more things. Because I know I've gone over the time. So now we've mentioned, how many points have we mentioned? Or how many characteristics? What was the first one? Huh? No. There's ikhtilaf among the scholars. Huh? اختلفوا إلى قولين. Huh? The first thing that I mentioned was cleaning the vessel of knowledge. And that is what? The heart. And I mentioned under it three characteristics. Or three diseases and sicknesses. What are these three diseases and sicknesses? The first one is what? Al-ma'asi in general. Second one? Al-kibr. Arrogance. Third one? Hasad. Envy. Now we're going to take another one, my brothers and my sisters. When a person, he seeks knowledge, he's not doing it for the sake of Allah. Maybe he's trying to do it for a portion of the dunya. Al-Usaymi, حفظه الله تعالى, he says, وَمَا سَبَقَ مَنْ سَبَقَ وَلَا وَصَلَ مَنْ وَصَلَ مِنَ السَّلَفِ الصَّالِحِينَ إِلَّا بِالْإِخْلَاصِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The people of the past, my brothers and my sisters, they didn't proceed and they didn't reach a high level except because they were sincere لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. From the Salaf al-Salihin, my brothers and my sisters, and when we say Salaf, we mean the three golden generations, the Sahaba, the Tabi'in, the Tabi'ut Tabi'in. He also says, وَإِنَّمَا يَنَالُ الْمَرْءُ الْعِلْمَ عَلَىٰ قَدْرِ إِخْلَاصِهِ. One, he only attains knowledge in accordance to his sincerity. The more sincere he is, the more knowledge he's going to attain. Again, this is an action of the heart. And the less sincere he is, the less he's going to get. This is why when a person, my brothers and my sisters, seeks knowledge, he has the intent of doing four things. And the poet rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions this. فَلْتَقْسِدُوا أَرْبَعَةً قَبْلَ ابْتِدَى تَعَلُّمٍ لِكَيْ تَفُوزُوا بِالْهُدَى. He says, make sure you come with four things, or you have the intent of four, so you can be successful. أولها الخروج من ضلالي والثاني نفع الخلق للجلالي. The first thing is, my brothers and my sisters, from sincerity, if you're going to be sincere, that you're trying to remove yourself from the darkness, the misguidance. رفع الجهل عن نفسك, to remove the ignorance from yourself. والثاني نفع الخلق للجلالي. Then my brothers and my sisters, it is to remove the ignorance from others for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. When we learn the chapter of menses, we as guys, why are we learning it? Does anyone here have a monthly cycle? Huh? But we learn it because of what? For our sisters, and so we can take the information and relay it back, right, and benefit others. وَثَالِثُ الْإِحْيَاءُ لِلْعُلُومِ وَالرَّابِعُ الْعَمَلُ بِالْمَعْلُومِ. And the third thing, my brothers and my sisters, the third intent when seeking knowledge is to revive knowledge. Knowledge has died out today, my brothers and my sisters, it really has. Going through books, everybody wants lectures. When I come back in the summer, wallahi, it really tires and exhausts me to go around the country and give lectures. A lot of the time, it's قَلِيلُ الْفَائِدَةِ. It is very, very less in benefit. Why? Because all that does is, it increases somebody's iman, but it doesn't maintain it. In order for you to maintain your iman, is to learn about Allah and to go through books. Books like Usul al-Fiqh, Aqeedah, also Mustalah al-Hadith. Today has died out in the Ummah, it really has. This is why it's really amazing that our brothers are starting a program tomorrow, going through books. وَالرَّابِعُ الْعَمَلُ بِالْمَعْلُومِ. And the fourth is to act upon the knowledge that you are learning. Why am I studying? Am I studying because tomorrow I want the minbar? I want to be on top of that minbar. Or am I studying because I want everybody to see me as the shaykh? What did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? من تعلم علما مما يبتغى به وجه الله لا يتعلمه إلا ليصيب به عرضا من الدنيا أدخله الله النار. Whoever learns knowledge that which is normally learnt in order to seek the face of Allah Azza wa Jal, but he only does that in order to seek a portion of the dunya, he wants something of the dunya, Allah Azza wa Jal will enter him into the fire. In another hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من تعلم العلم ليماري به السفهاء. Whoever learns knowledge in order just so he can go back and argue with those who are foolish. Sometimes this happens, right? We quickly want to go learn something just so we can argue with that individual and we can get one over him. It's not about brownie points, guys. It really isn't. أو ليباهي به العلماء. Or he learns knowledge just so he can boast about it. The scholars can see, oh, mashallah. Sometimes an individual might ask a question just so that scholar can think, wow, he actually is thinking about these kind of things. أو ليصرف به وجوه الناس إليه. Or he learns knowledge so he can turn the faces to his direction. Later on, he wants to be seen as the hafid, or he wants to be seen as the shaykh. لم يجد عرف الجنة. This individual won't be able to smell the fragrance of Jannah. Oh, I want to be known as the qari, or the student of so and so. Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? This is really, really vital. It is very, very vital. That's why one should constantly be fighting with his nafs. Am I doing it for Allah's sake? Always before the action, and also while that action is taking place, and after he's done with that particular action. Did I really do it for Allah Azza wa Jal? One time Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhaili in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's masjid. You know what he said, guys? Imagine Allah Azza wa Jal, he chose you from all of these millions of Muslims to seek knowledge. And on top of that, for you to sit in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's masjid. But then you come in Yawm al-Qiyamah and you wasted all of that because you weren't sincere. Allah chose us, guys, to be able to sit today in the masjid. While many people are going to be partying tonight on this Friday. What if an individual, he feels like he's not sincere? He goes, I'm not going to seek knowledge because I'm not sincere. I don't feel like I'm sincere. What does he do? It's a question. He carries on seeking knowledge. Some people, they say, I'm not sincere, so I'm not going to seek knowledge. This individual, jama'a bayna al-jahli wal-humq, he's combined between two things, between ignorance and also stupidity. Why is that? He needs it, and he chooses to remain what? Ignorant. This is why Sufyan ibn Uyayni says, طَلَبْنَا الْعِلْمَ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَأَبَى إِلَّا يَكُونَ لِلَّهِ. First, we started seeking knowledge for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then it refused except for it to be for Allah azza wa jal's sake. What does he mean by that? A lot of people, my brothers and my sisters, when they first start seeking knowledge, they see a sheikh, all the attention that he's getting, he's got a chair, respect. When he walks in, he gets the best seat in the room. وَيُعْجِبُهُ هَذَا. And he finds it amazing, because everyone's giving him attention and love. So because of that, he starts seeking knowledge. But then he attends a class where sincerity is being spoken about. And then he realizes that I shouldn't be seeking knowledge in a certain way, or I shouldn't be learning the Quran in a certain way. And last but not least, my brothers and my sisters, this is point number... Five. Or you could say three, but five. It's five things we mentioned altogether, but the first was like a heading, and three types of diseases came under it. Also, my brothers and my sisters, what prevents an individual from being able to attain that knowledge, or to be able to seek or attain the sweetness of the Quran is قِلَّةُ الْأَدَبِ, having bad manners and etiquettes. Yusuf ibn Ya'qub al-Razi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, بِالْأَدَبِ تَفْهَمُ الْعِلْمِ. With good etiquette, that's how you're going to understand knowledge. They also say about, and this is what Imam al-Zuhri, rahimahullah ta'ala, Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, or Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, كَانَ أَبُو سَلَمَةَ الْكُوفِي يُمَارِي ibn Abbas. Abu Salam, he always used to argue with Ibn Abbas. فَحُرِمَ بِذَلِكَ عِلْمٌ كَثِيرٌ. And because of him not knowing how to speak to his teacher, he was deprived of a lot of knowledge. He didn't know how to speak to his teacher. This is why there's adab, my brothers and my sisters, with your teacher. There's adab also when sitting in a sitting. There's also etiquette, how you interact with your classmates. There's books that have been written on etiquettes and manners. Doesn't bother the teacher. He's not going to lose anything. But the one who's going to be deprived is what? Student. I've heard a student one time say to his teacher, and he didn't mean it. He didn't even realize that he was saying it. He's calling his teacher. He goes, yo. He says, yo, what was that thing that you mentioned again? We apologize after. Because he was from the road. He didn't realize. Some of the scholars, they said, my brothers and my sisters, أَخْشَى عَلَى مَنْ أَسَاءَ الْأَدَبَ فِي مَجْلِسِ الْعَالِمِ أَنْ يُحْبَطَ عَمَلُهُ أَوْ أَنْ يُحْبَطَ عِلْمُهُ وَهُوَ لَا يَشْعُرُ. What I fear for the person who ends up having bad manners and etiquette in the sitting of a scholar is that all his ilm will go to waste from where he doesn't expect. Look where they took this from. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? وَلَا تَجْهَرُوا لَهُ بِالْقَوْلِ كَجَهْرِ بَعْضِكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ أَنْ تَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Do not raise your voice over the voice of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is in the time of when he was still living. Are you with me, my brothers and my sisters? What could happen if they do that? the actions will become null, it will become void. Today the hadith are mentioned, right? You might have an individual in the back. When the hadith are being mentioned, he's laughing and joking and he's texting. He's raising his voice. This is why, my brothers and my sisters, the people of the past, when the hadith were being mentioned, their heads would be dropping in humility to that which is being mentioned. He would be concentrating. He wouldn't dare to speak over the statements of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam when the hadith are being mentioned. I remember one time as well, Sheikh Saleh Al-Usaymi. And this class that happens every year, my brothers and my sisters, over many thousands of people, they attend in the Prophet's Masjid. The Sheikh comes all the way from Riyadh. He goes through 16 books in 8 days. One time the phone started ringing. The Sheikh was like, switch off your phones. Then he rang again. And then the third time he rang. You know what the Sheikh done? He got up and he left. He wanted to teach them a lesson. And a teacher might do that. Might just get up and leave. Or if that individual doesn't know how to speak to him. You got a brother, sometimes he speaks to his teacher as if he has a right over him to give him that knowledge. There's a lot of etiquette, my brothers and my sisters, that are mentioned, which we're not going to have time for. The way you address your teacher, the way you speak to him, your madrasa teacher who's teaching your Quran is going to be horrible to you sometimes. But you have to be really, really patient. And you don't treat him like your classmate. One time I saw a brother to his teacher. He came, tuck, on his head, like that. And then he goes, I was joking. Some things are not appropriate. You don't deal with your teacher the same way you. And one time one guy just came and started touching his head. That's why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, my brothers and my sisters, إِنَّ مِنْ إِجْلَالِ اللَّهِ إِكْرَامَ ذِي شَيْبَةِ الْمُسْلِمِ. From honoring Allah Azza wa Jal is to be noble towards the man who's really old in age. وَحَامِلِ الْقُرْآنِ غَيْرِ الْغَالِ فِيهِ وَالْجَافِعًا. And also the one who is holding the Qur'an, the one who's memorized the Qur'an, but without going overboard. Not taking away from his right, and also having ghulu, extremes, being extreme in his regard. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my brothers and my sisters, to benefit us from what we heard. I hope inshallah ta'ala we all benefited from that, and we have that on the back of our minds when we try to seek knowledge. It's always a pleasure coming here. Lecture wasn't even meant to be happening, but it was very, very last minute. So jazakumullah khair, all of you guys, for attending and listening attentively. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if He doesn't gather us in this dunya again, to gather us all together fi jannat al-firdawsi الأعلى. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب جهنم إن عذابها كان غراما إنها ساءت مستقرا ومقاما. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Three books of the etiquette of seeking knowledge. One book that you can buy inshallah ta'ala is Tadhkiratu Sami'i wal Mutakallim by Ibn Jama'at al-Kinani rahimahullah ta'ala. And you find that Sheikh Ali al-Halabi, who's from the student of Sheikh al-Albani, he summarized it. And he quoted Al-Mu'lim fi Adab al-Alami wal Muta'allim. That's a lovely kitab that every single talib ilm should try to buy. But it's in Arabic. Also, there's another kitab by Hamad Uthman from Kuwait. And that name of the kitab has just surpassed my mind at this moment in time. Also, there's another wonderful explanation by Sheikh bin Uthaymeen on the Muqaddimah the introduction of the Majmu' للنووي رحمه الله تعالى. It's one مجلد. What he did was he was explaining the introduction of the Kitab of Imam Nawawi رحمه الله تعالى called Al-Majmu'. Al-Majmu' is like maybe over 25 مجلد depending on the طبع. So he done an explanation on the introduction because it speaks about the adab, the etiquette and the manners. Also you have, and how can I forget, Hilyatu Talib al-Ilm by Bakr Abu Zayd. Also Shaykh bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he has a kitab, I think it's called, what's the kitab of Shaykh bin Uthaymeen called? I think it's called Kitab al-Ilm, na'am, Kitab al-Ilm by Shaykh bin Uthaymeen. Na'am. Any other questions, guys? Can I go through it? Inshallah, we'll see next year. Bi-inillahi ta'ala. Inshallah. I'm leaving on Sunday, going back to, because of Hajj. So, and this year, this is the only time I came to Masjid al-Furqan al-Sharif. The Honorable Masjid al-Furqan. You guys, wallahi guys, you're very, very lucky. I don't like using the word lucky, but you're very fortunate to have Sheikh Muhammad Ali here. Wallahi al-Azim. Someone who graduated from Medina a very long time ago. He has a lot of ilm. I take advice from him sometimes because he's older than me in age. Don't unappreciate the people of knowledge that you guys have around you. He's a knowledgeable brother that can bring a lot to the table. And he's the Imam of the Masjid now. I remember before they used to bring in Khatibs, different Khatibs all the time, and I used to be one of them, I used to come. Now you have a settled da'i over here, Sheikh Muhammad Ali. Benefit from him. You have other brothers as well, Ustad Abu al-Abbas, who comes every week, I think, every Saturday. Another lovely brother who graduated a long time ago. And you have other brothers are going to be graduating very soon, inshallah ta'ala, that you guys can benefit from. You've got brother Hudayfa, you also have brother Abdul Salam, and the other brother who's going to be, inshallah, in a couple of years graduating. So there's a lot of brothers you can seek advice from, you can benefit from. I can give, you know, something that you might not necessarily have, even if it is revising knowledge. بارك الله فيكم وأحسن الله إليكم. Any others? Huh? جزاكم الله خير, my brothers and my sisters. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. وياكم.